as is right, and do not go on sinning. For some have no knowledge of God. I say this to your shame.
Thanks, Liz. Good evening, everyone. James is my name. Great to see you. And why don't we pray together? Father, we do thank you for your word. We thank you that we can sit under it tonight. We pray that you might use this word to speak to us, that we might live it out for your glory and honour. Amen. There are times when you will make difficult decisions in the present because of what you think will happen in the future. You'll make difficult decisions in the present because of what you think will happen in the future. Just for the next minute, have a chat to the people around you. What are the times in which you will do those things? You'll make difficult decisions in the present because of what will happen in the future. 1 minute, go, or come, see how you go. Okay, let's see how you go. Some of you have had to learn that you need to make a decision to go to bed at a certain time so you can get up in the morning and go to work. That's just life. That's growing up, okay? Some of you have learned that I've got to give up smashed avo so that I can buy a house one day. Not in Sydney, that'd be ridiculous, but, you know, in somewhere nice like Adelaide. Difficult decisions in the present so that the future looks better. I think if you can get that kind of concept in your head, it'll make sense, much more sense of this passage we look at tonight, 1 Corinthians 15. What we saw last week, if you were here in those first 19 verses of chapter 15, is Paul's kind of negative case. He said, let's assume that Jesus didn't rise from the dead. What are the consequences? What he does here from verse 20 is look at the positive case. But in fact, Jesus did rise from the dead. Therefore, there are a whole bunch of implications that we've got to take seriously. If Jesus didn't rise from the dead, look back at verse 17, we're still in our sins and our faith is futile. So what does it mean for Jesus to rise from the dead? One of the other things we've seen, just in terms of context, is that this whole question of the resurrection of Jesus is one of the two key pillars on which Christian faith stands. Joe talked last week about a kind of Jenga tower and the two blocks at the bottom being the cross of Christ and his resurrection. You kind of try and pull out one of these two blocks and the whole Christian faith falls apart. If you don't have the cross of Christ and the resurrection of Christ as the kind of foundation stones of your faith, it just doesn't make sense. So what difference does the resurrection of Jesus make to my life? What difference does it make? First point, if you're taking down notes, the future starts now. The future starts now. Specifically, Paul's first point here is that Jesus' resurrection signals the beginning of the end. Verse 20, but in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. Now, when we read that word first fruits, most of us are kind of scratching our head because we grew up in the city and don't have a clue about anything vaguely rural. I've done some research for you. First fruits, it's the beginning of the harvest. So when we did live in a country town in Adelaide, we used to take our kids strawberry picking, and so we'd turn up in October, and you go up there, and there'd be fresh strawberries, and you'd pluck them to your heart's content. And you do that happily, knowing that you could do this every Saturday for the coming 6 months. that you saw strawberries in October guaranteed that you could still be picking them in May. It was the beginning of the harvest. Some now, but many, many, many more to come. That's the idea of the first fruits. They guarantee the rest of the harvest. They signal that there is much more to come. That's Paul's point about Jesus' resurrection. Jesus' resurrection, if you like, wasn't a unique event. Jesus wasn't the only one who will rise. Everyone who follows him will rise too. He was the first person, he was the most significant person, but for those who follow him, we will rise too. What happens to Jesus will happen to those who trust him. Look at verse 21, because this makes it a whole lot clearer. For as by a man came death, by a man has also come the resurrection of the dead. Here's a summary of all of world history in 18 words. You don't need a book for this, you just need 18 words. And this summary involves the two key people in all of human history. Not Mother Teresa, not Winston Churchill, not Barack Obama. Two key people that actually make sense of all of world history. First one, Adam. What's Adam's great contribution to world history? Have a look there. Death. Thank you, Adam. You well played. You have brought death into the world. We're very, very impressed. Okay? Because of Adam, because of his sin, everyone who comes after him will die. What else then? As by man came death, by man has also come the resurrection of the dead. And so there's a second person, this person Jesus. And so with Jesus, the problem of death is no more. Once death was the great leveler. Once death was the incontrovertible truth that all of us would face. But by this other man, everything changes. Look at verse 22. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. All of human history has shifted with the resurrection of Jesus. Now there's this second possible destination for humanity. Either we follow Adam and suffer death, or we follow Jesus and are made alive forever. Those are our choices. There is no other. What Paul then does is kind of spell out God's agenda, God's program of how this will all happen from verse 23. And this kind of timeline doesn't revolve just around two people, but two events. The first event is the resurrection of Jesus in about AD 33, that world-changing event 2,000 years ago. The next big event in world history hasn't happened yet. It's summarized there, verse 23, by those words, at his coming. Jesus came to earth once to live and die and rise again, and he will come to earth again to bring the great harvest field, to bring in all the fruit. Verse 24, to deliver to God the Father the kingdom. The kingdom that was secured by his death and resurrection. Now, what does all this mean then? It's spelled out there in verse 24 and verse 25. Then comes the end, when he delivers the kingdom to God the Father after destroying every rule and every authority and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. What this means is that our destiny is no longer tied to Adam. Our future is no longer only death. The last enemy to be destroyed by Jesus is death. We don't like to talk about death much. Most of us don't really want to face death, if we're honest. And in our modern world, we don't have to. Unlike most countries and cultures in the world and throughout history, we don't see death up close. We're shielded from its sheer awfulness. It happens somewhere else. And more than that, we invent phrases to hide the sheer horror of death. There's been a whole lot of talk recently about dying with dignity when it comes to the voluntary assisted dying legislation. It's admirable to want to die with dignity. The difficulty is it's a nonsense, from my experience at least. There is nothing dignified about death. Whenever it comes, however it comes, it is just awful. I sat in hospital this week with a man who'd been told he has prostate cancer. There's nothing wonderful about it. There's deep stress and anxiety and pain. And that was just the prospect of death. We had a Thanksgiving service yesterday here for someone who died at the age of 100. Surely that's a good life. Surely we can celebrate her life. Yeah, and we did our best, but to deny the grief that was in the building would be monstrous. I don't want to die. My suspicion is that you don't want to die either. Death is our biggest enemy. And there's nothing we can do about it. Until we see the difference that Jesus makes. Unless God's great future has come in the resurrection of Jesus, all of us face death. All of us face God's judgment, and that is going to be ugly. But with the promise of Jesus' return, death will be destroyed. But there's more than that. It's not just that the future starts with Jesus' resurrection. The future shapes our life now. Come to the second half of the passage from verse 29. The future shapes now. It's not good English, but there you go. How does the news of God's future impact on our lives now? That's what we need to work out. Before we get there, we just need to kind of work our way through verse 29, which I think is probably the trickiest verse in all of 1 Corinthians. So have a look there. Otherwise, what do people mean by being baptized on behalf of the dead? I don't know how you went with this in growth groups during the week. It's a doozy, isn't it? What is going on here? The good news is there's only 40 possible explanations for this. And so I figure if I just go through each of those over the next few minutes, that'll be good for all of us. No, I'm not going to do that at all. From the context, it kind of, I think we can make sense of it a bit. It looks like what people did was to get baptized on behalf of their Christian brothers and sisters who died without being baptized. Strange thing to do. That's not Paul's point. He's not commenting on the practice. What he's commenting on is in the second half of the verse there. Verse 29 again. If the dead are not raised at all, why are people baptized on their behalf? He's pointing out the utterly illogical nature of what they're doing. You guys don't believe in the resurrection. Why on earth would you do this baptism on the behalf of the dead thing? It just doesn't make sense. Which just raises the issue for them of how will you respond appropriately to the resurrection? Both the resurrection of Jesus and the resurrection that all of God's people face. Paul begins to answer this question by talking personally. Have a look at what he does from verse 30. Why are we in danger every hour? I protest, brothers, by my pride in you, which I have in Christ Jesus our Lord. I die every day. What do I gain if, humanly speaking, I fought with beasts at Ephesus? If the dead are not raised, let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. How does that make sense? And what on earth were those beasts that Paul was fighting with in Ephesus? Again, what we're trying to do is work out how the resurrection of Jesus impacts our life now. Paul's response is to say, I will suffer, I will make sacrifices, I will fight even these beasts at Ephesus. Now, what are those beasts at Ephesus? Notice that Paul's already speaking in hyperbole. It's fairly colourful language. I don't think he does die every hour. That's just a way of speaking. Also, these beasts are not real beasts. That is, it's a metaphor to talk about the way people treated him in Ephesus. You go back and have a look at the end of Acts chapter 19, and the riot in Ephesus. And it's a way of Paul reflecting on the animal-like behavior there. The bigger question is, why does Paul commend this particular response, his response, to our future resurrection? Why put ourselves in danger? Why risk our lives? Why contend with opponents? It's so dramatic. It's a little bit negative. What's behind it? What's worse is that Paul's not just speaking personally. That is, this is not just story time with Paul. He's saying this is actually a model response to the future certain hope of resurrection with Jesus. This is not just my response. I'm commending this response to you guys as well. Follow my example. Not necessarily to face death and suffering, but at the very least, to live lives that are looked and shaped differently because of the future resurrection. To have aspirations and ambitions that are different because we now understand what will happen in the future. At the end of verse 32, if the dead are not raised, let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. Again, it's a negative argument that he's done in the first 19 verses. If there's no resurrection, live it up. Just party as hard as you possibly can, because we're here today and gone tomorrow. We're Madonna's material girls living in a material world. What is here, and that is that. If there's no resurrection, we're not here for a long time, we're here for a good time, so enjoy it while you can. But because there is a resurrection to come, because the dead will be raised, your life will look very different now. If we live in this space between the resurrection of Jesus in AD 33 and the resurrection to come, that will focus our minds, that will focus our lives, that will focus our ambitions in such a way that we will live differently. And Paul speaks very kind of aggressively almost here in these last couple of verses. Have a look there. Wake up from your drunken stupor, as is right, and do not go on sinning, for some have no knowledge of God. I say this to your shame. Like, he sounds pretty cranky, doesn't he? If Jesus is coming again, the time has come to wake up. The Corinthians have made a mess of a whole bunch of things, as we've seen over the last few weeks. They were celebrating in ways that were utterly inappropriate. They were glorifying in immorality. They were boasting of their knowledge and pitting one leader against another. And Paul's saying, for goodness sake, wake up! Jesus is coming again, and that needs to change all of this. My question is, do we need a wake-up call too? Is it possible that we are in danger of making the same mistake as the Corinthians? Our vision is on living it up, celebrating the good life, personal enjoyment, personal fulfillment, living the way I want to live, doing with my body what I want to do with my body. That's an error. God's word says, wake up. What we do now matters. How we decide to live now matters because of what is coming in the future. John and Pip were in the US for some time and went to a church with a preacher by the name of John Piper, who famously spoke once about how to waste your life. He was reflecting on the death of two missionaries at his church, and people kept talking about what a tragic loss of life it was for these missionaries to die fairly young in their life in a car accident. Here's what he said, and I won't use his accent because I can't, and you'll laugh at me. "Was that a tragedy? Two lives driven by one great vision, spent in unheralded service for the glory of Jesus Christ? That's not a tragedy. That's a glory. I'll tell you what a tragedy is. Bob and Penny took early retirement from their jobs when he was 59 and she was 51. Now they live in Florida, where they cruise on a boat playing softball and collecting shells. That's a tragedy. People today spend billions of dollars persuading you to embrace that tragic dream. And I get to say to you, don't buy it. With all my heart, I plead with you, don't buy that dream. A nice house, a nice car, a nice job, a nice family, a nice retirement, collecting shells as the last chapter before you stand before the Creator of the universe to give an account on what you did. Here it is, Lord, my shell collection. And look at my boat. Don't waste your life." In 1 Corinthians 15, Paul pleads with the Corinthians. He pleads with us. Don't waste your life. Don't live as if the resurrection won't happen. It's been guaranteed. It's been secured by Jesus' resurrection himself, the first fruits. Live with a razor-sharp focus on what is coming. On eternity. It's so challenging for us to get this right, I think. We live in the most comfortable city in the world, in the most prosperous time in history. We need to keep encouraging each other just how powerfully difficult this is. It doesn't come naturally to us. We need each other's help. More than that, we need God's help. So let's turn to him in prayer now. Why don't you bow your heads and we'll pray. Our Father, we pray that in your kindness you would give us this kind of focus. You would take our minds and our hearts to what is to come, to the certain resurrection of your people. We pray that our ambitions, our achievements in this world, what we long for, would all come under the lordship of Jesus and the future resurrection. Help us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.